Good evening. My name is Hortense Crozier-Persick, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true name, the true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus or Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud, in like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelation. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach about the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Nine, to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10th, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We will now have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser, a scripture lesson by Dr. Lynette Mamaris, and a selection of music, and our scripture lesson will be Isaiah 45.
Good evening, class. Let us bow our hearts and mind, and let us clear our hearts and mind. We ask Joshua to just clear it. Humble our hearts that we may be able to hear, to see the things that you will present to us tonight concerning your purpose, pattern, and your plan. And even those things that we may not want to see, that we keep our minds open, that all these things that you present to us is for our learning, and it is of your will and not ours. But by grace, you are allowing these things to happen because we are the sons, and this is what we need to bring us into the consciousness of that. So all these things and many others we ask in thy son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Don't give me earthly things, just give me all your love. Thank you, Dr. Jeanette Ramirez and Dr. Eunice Ryder. This evening,
good evening, class.
It's Thursday.
Good evening, class. My name is Nanette Ramirez, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina, the Scripture Research Associations. I'll be reading Isaiah, the 45th chapter. Thus saith Yahweh to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have strengthened, to subdue nations before him. And I will loose the loins of kings to open before him the two levied gates, and the gates shall not be shut. I will go before thee and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass and cut in sunder the bars of iron. And I will give thee the treasures of darkness and hidden riches of secret places, that thou mayest know that I, Yahweh, which call thee by thy name, am the Elohim of Israel. For Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel mine elect, I have even called thee by thy name. I have surnamed thee, though thou hast not known me. I am Yahweh, and there is none else. There is no Elohim besides me. I girded thee, though thou hast not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is none besides me. I am Yahweh, and there is none else. I form the light and create the darkness. I make peace and create punishments. I, Yahweh, do all these things. Drop down, ye heavens, from above, and let the skies pour down. Righteousness, let the earth open, and let them bring forth salvation, and let righteousness spring up together. I, Yahweh, have created it. Woe unto him that striveth with his maker. Let the potsherd strive with the potsherd of the earth. Shall the clay say to him that fashioneth, what makest thou? Or thy work, he hath no hands. Woe unto him that saith unto his father, what begettest thou? Or to the woman, what hast thou brought forth? Thus saith Yahweh, that holy name of Israel, and his maker, will you ask me of things to come concerning my sons, and concerning the work of my hands? Will ye command me? Yet I have made the earth and created man upon it. I even my hands have stretched out the heavens, and all their host have I commanded. I have raised up in righteousness, and I will direct all his ways. He shall build my city, and he shall let go my captives, not for price nor reward, saith Yahweh of hosts. Thus saith Yahweh, the labor of Egypt and merchandise of Ethiopia and of the Sabaeans, men of stature, shall come over unto thee, and they shall be thine. They shall come after thee, in chains they shall come over, and they shall fall down unto thee. They shall make supplication unto thee, saying, surely El is in thee, and there is none else. There is no Elohim. Verily, thou art an El that hideth thyself, O Elohim of Israel, the Savior. They shall be ashamed and also confounded, all of them. They shall go to confusion together, that all makers of idols. But Israel shall be saved in Yahweh with an everlasting salvation. Ye shall not be ashamed nor confounded unto eternity. For thus saith Yahweh that created the heavens, Elohim himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. I am Yahweh, and there is none else. I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye me in vain. I, Yahweh, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves and come. draw near together. Ye that are escaped of the nations, they have no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven image and pray unto an idol that cannot save. Tell ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together. Who hath declared this from ancient time? Who hath foretold it from ancient time? Have not I Yahweh? And there is no Elohim beside me, a just El and a Savior. There is none beside me. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am El, and there is none else. I have sworn by myself that the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness, and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Surely shall one say, in Yahweh I have righteousness and strength. Even to him shall men come, and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In Yahweh shall all the seed of Israel be justified, and shall glory. I have read Isaiah, the 45th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Sorry about that. I was looking at a scripture. Thank you, Dr. Lynette Ramirez. This evening is Tuesday, our open testimony or lecture night. So if anyone would like to say or give a testimony, please come forward.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Today is Tuesday. It's our workshop night, typically. However, you know, we're not prone by any law specifically. And because it was made mention that it was a testimony and someone has something to say, and by all means, whether it's a testimony night or a lecture night, if you have something on your heart and mind that you would like to share, make it known, and we will be more than happy to accommodate you. And with that being said, I'd like to have Maria come and give a testimony or a lecture.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everybody. I just want to, the last time I was here, I was up and made a testimony, and I didn't really explain myself well. Okay. I said that I wasn't good at correlating this, you know, this teaching. Mm-hmm. And then afterwards, my brother here, Aaron, He said, well, I saw you correlating, you know, what you were correlating, you know, the talking about how this, I didn't actually go through the correlation, but I said that that the body and the tabernacle correlated, and how the trek of the children of Israel correlated with the tabernacle also. Now, I've been in this school for many, many, many years. I'm not even going to tell you how many years. And I have learned how this gospel, I have learned the teaching, I'm not going to call it the gospel, the teaching of Dr. Kinley. And I have gone through the whole thing. I used to be able to, I haven't done it in a long time, haven't practiced, but I know that I can take you through the whole trek and all the steps and all the furnishings in the tabernacle, and you know, like this, and correlate them with the body and with the trek and everything. I'm not good at. I don't even know why that came up. Why did I even start with that last time? You know, I love the way that it's explained here when our dean correlates the scriptures, the actual scriptures, with the events here and with and using Dr. Kenley's vision and revelation of how the blood, water, and spirit correlate, and you've never heard this, at least I've never heard this from any other religion or church, you know? Yet it's there, I mean, because the pictures show you the stories that are in the scripture. You can't deny that it's in the scriptures, because, you know, but to correlate them and bring line upon line and blood, water, spirit, and, you know, that is where it's different from what you hear in the world. You never hear that. You know, I mean, they know that there's a tabernacle, but whoever teaches a tabernacle in any religion, I've never heard it, you know? And yet Yahweh said in the to Moses, make sure that you make it exactly like I have shown it to you. There has to be a reason. Why would he say? And then once you look at it, there's intricate details about how the tabernacle is structured, the parts, besides the steps, it's the furnishings, and, you know, everything has a reason and a purpose, and nobody has ever given it any importance. I mean, I've seen churches out there that have on their the titles, the Tabernacle of Christ, well, whatever, you know, the Tabernacle of this, whatever, and then you have the Tabernacle Choir, you know, the Mormons and all this stuff, but nobody ever really, you know, it's just like they never give it any real importance, and this is school, you can learn all of that, besides learning what Dr. Kenley was teaching about what he saw, his vision and his revelation. You also learn about other things in the world, other religions, you know how things work with the. It's just incredible how it. It's just. I don't know how to say it. It's just. Well, this is the place. You know, if you want to know about something, this is the place. You know, yeah. Anything and everything can be explained with a pattern. And that is like one of the most important things, the pattern, okay? The names, to find out what the names are, and the school, you can learn that, and it shows proof of why it's the way that it is. And the tabernacle with the body. And the ultimate goal is to learn that Yahshua, the Messiah, is the Father, and that he did come in the flesh to redeem us, and when you learn that, when you know that, then you know who you are. That is the ultimate goal. I believe that that's the ultimate goal, is to learn that Yahshua is in you, and that's like you're getting the Holy Spirit. You know, you're not going to be acting any different, really. You know, you're not going to grow wings, but you will have knowledge, and it may make a change in you, the way you behave, you know, because without the Holy Spirit, you don't know really what you're doing, you know, if you're right or wrong about something, you know. I mean, the world has you following rules and regulations and laws, because we have to have order. We can't be out there just all, you know, crazy, just, you know, doing whatever, whenever you want, you know. You have to have order, so, you know, the Spirit gives you that spiritual order that you need to know, so that you become enlightened. It opens your eyes to what Yahweh wants, you know, your steps that you have to take. Excuse me, I'm losing my voice now. So anyway, that's what I wanted to explain, because I didn't really make myself very clear last time. And also I wanted to say that even this teaching is not your salvation. It is the road to salvation, the tools, the guidelines, because you can learn all of this thing. You could learn all of this. You could learn. You don't have to, how can I say, believe in this school, in this teaching. You know, you can learn it. Was said when I first started coming to this class, Dr. Ken used to say, you can Paul pair it. You know, you can. Memorize. You can memorize this whole thing, the whole thing. You can memorize the Bible. It's been done. It's been done out in the world. It's, you know, there's a lot of people that have memorized the whole Bible. You know, that doesn't mean that they're saved or that they really know Yahweh. And that's the way it is with us, for us to hear. You have to take this seriously. You know, you have to become this, the gospel, you know. Dr. Kennedy used to say you have to get behind the charts, not just look at the charts, but let them be inside of you, that which you get from it. You know, it's like when you eat your food, the essence of the food gets into your blood, and that's what makes you. So the essence of the teaching will become your spirit, and you know, then hopefully we know who we are, and that is our salvation. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Maria. That was beautiful. Like I said, anytime anybody has anything on their heart and mind, we're more than happy to yield the floor and hear what thus saith Yahshua the Messiah. And we'll work with it, as she quite eloquently said, that we work with everything in order to gain some more clarity and some more purpose of what these charts reveal, if you would, according to a pattern and a purpose. You see, because we have a pattern, we can take it off of this chart and apply it to the things in the world, whereby we're able to measure and to judge and to ascertain what's going on, and be able to either move or stand still according to the happenings in the world. You see, and as we become more skillful and more confident in that pattern, in the things that we've learned of the pattern, and knowing that Yahweh will see it through according to His will, and if we be of Yahweh, it will be of our will. Grab me back over here in Isaiah, if you would. I skimmed through it as Maria was speaking. And I don't know, start at 10. Let me hear what that say.
Isaiah 45 and 10.
It's going to be in harmony with what Maria just talked about and what we're going to go in tonight in the textbook in the second volume on page 14. We're going to start. Go ahead.
Isaiah 45 and 10. Woe unto him that saith unto his father, what begettest thou? Or to the woman, what hast thou brought forth? Thus saith Yahweh, the Holy One of Israel and his Maker. Will you ask me of things to come concerning my sons and concerning the work of my hands? Will ye command me?
Now, Yahweh is expressing through Isaiah that there's none other than him, essentially. And just like he just expressed here, are you going to ask the woman with child, what is she having, essentially? Because she don't know herself.
Right.
You follow? And we're coming into a realization by using this divine vision and revelation that Dr. Kinley had and the instructions that he put together based off the scriptures and the subsequent books, we're able to glean or perceive something about Yahweh our Elohim. You follow? Because we have to come through Yahshua the Messiah to know anything about our Father. You follow? And not everybody knows everything about our Father. Let's keep reading down through here in Isaiah just a little bit. I want to expedite a little bit. Go ahead and skip to 45 and 19.
I have not spoken in secret.
Now, he's not speaking in secret because we have this teaching. We're on YouTube and we're making it known. You know, we don't have all the money. We don't have all the fanfare and the TV media that some may have. But nonetheless, this is not in secret. We don't speak in secret. And anybody dare come to speak, we're going to be up front row and center when it comes to the scriptures and comes to salvation of anybody's soul. You follow? Keep reading about this secret.
I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I said not unto the seed of Jacob.
Now follow, listen closely, because she, as Maria just expressed, she knows the story. She's heard the story too. We've all read through the story, but we've been made particular notice about this Abrahamic promise made to a seed. And that seed is singular. You follow? So say the book. But now, mind you, let's listen to how Isaiah is talking about this seed. Read.
Seek ye me in vain. I, Yahweh, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves.
Yahweh don't lie. He's not coming down here to play games with his mere creatures. You follow? There's no need for that, for him to be like that. It's his story. It's his purpose. You follow? And what he set out, which was this seed, is not going to return into him void. Right. Let's keep reading about this seed.
Assemble yourselves and come.
Is that singular or plural?
Seed.
Keep
singular.
Keep reading. It said assemble yourself or yourselves.
Plural.
That's plural. Reread that again from the start.
Assemble yourselves and come. Draw near together.
Reread that from that seed, please.
Okay. I have not spoken in secret in a dark place of the earth. I said, not unto the seed of Jacob. Seek ye me in vain.
Now, Jacob is Israel, correct? Jacob had 12 sons. Let's keep reading of this seed of Jacob.
I, Yahweh, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right. Assemble yourselves and come.
Plural. Yourselves to come. Read.
Draw near together.
Draw near together.
Read. Ye that are escaped of the nations.
That you've escaped of the nations if you believe in Yahweh. The nations are the other denominations and then other thoughts, concepts, theories, and opinions. But there's only one Yahweh. There's only one gospel. There's only one righteousness in this earth plane. And it's expressing here through Isaiah that assemble yourselves, not just one person. Although we know that the scriptures are about Yahshua Messiah, sure enough. But you're talking about a principle here. That we have to assemble ourselves because it's the body that's going to make up Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading.
They have no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven.
They don't have that knowledge or the vision that's been given to Dr. Kinley over and beyond anybody else's vision. I have to say it like that because, hey, other people have visions. Yeah. Other people created great denominations. They have multiple people, multiple thousands of people. Yeah. Even the Pope in himself has a vision, thinking that Peter been to Rome.
Yeah.
He had an imagination that he's the victor. Vicarious victor, or the vicar of the Son of God. The one in charge. Thank you for that. That you got to go through him while you're on this earth plane and speak something to him, and that he might run and go tell Mary now, and then if she busy, go run and tell the Lord, as though he's going to interpret for you. What did Isaiah write that Yahweh told him about these idols?
And pray unto an idol that cannot save.
That can't save. That Pope can't save.
Tell ye and bring them near. Mm-hmm. Yea, let them take counsel together.
Mm-hmm.
Who hath declared this from ancient time?
Mm-hmm.
Who has foretold it from ancient time? Have not I Yahweh? Mm-hmm. And there is no Elohim besides me.
Okay.
A just El and a Savior. There is none besides me.
Elohim's the Savior. And there's none else besides him. They set up all that we have in this earth plane. As Maria said, it's for our learning. And our learning is about one Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? Whom Yahweh has sent. Keep reading on down a little bit.
Look unto me and be ye saved.
You got to look unto Yahshua. You got to find him. You got to look. You got to look at something. We're looking not at these charts, and as colorful as they may be, and we're not looking at the individual stories. We're looking at an invisible Elohim, an invisible spirit that can be drawn out and made manifest in your consciousness. Just like here on the day that Yahshua ascended into heaven. We're going to read a little bit about it today because we had a question, something about this day here, the first and second chapter of Acts. And you have, in the story goes that Yahshua resurrected or went up or ascended up into the clouds. And you have people here that were gazing up into the clouds. You follow? And you got two men in white apparel here telling those all those people looking up, talking about, why are you looking up?
Right.
That this Son of Man is going to return in like fashion.
Right.
But they and everybody else, the Pope on down, think that he done went up into the sky, literally and physically so. But they missed the statement of the two witnesses telling them that he ain't go up there like that. And this is what Isaiah is talking about. Read.
Look unto me and see, be ye saved.
You're not looking to him and going up into the sky as though he's going to wait to come back, as though that what you think in your imagination is going to save you. That's why we got to keep breaking it down, keep going over, keep rehearsing, and let us know that what we're looking, make sure we know what we're looking at. Either whether we are on the floor or talking to somebody out in the streets, it makes no difference. Because the gospel is not in a house, it's not in a place, it's not in a building. You follow? So we're talking nonstop, Facebooking and Instagramming and shooting pictures and pricking people, trying to get them, at least I do, see who have the ear to hear. Right? Keep reading.
All the ends of the earth, for I am El. And there is none else.
What verse you at?
Now I'm on 23.
Okay, keep going.
I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness.
Now that word's gone out. That's the vision. That's the report. And this is the report that we're reading and talking about based off the scriptures. Because Isaiah 8 and 20 says, to the law and to the testimony.
Right.
If they speak, that's the word. If they speak, that's your word. If you speak, there's no light in them if they don't speak according to the law and in the testimony. So that's the word that's gone out. And then we know that word is not that Bible that people strum around and they read and want to whip out on you every 5 or 6 seconds when they see you doing something. That's not the word. That's those nations that ignorantly worship that idol. Mm-hmm. But keep reading.
And shall not return. That unto me every knee shall bow and every tongue shall swear.
Mm-hmm.
Surely shall one say, in Yahweh have I righteousness and strength. Even to him shall men come and all that are incensed against him shall be ashamed. In Yahweh shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory.
Now all the seed of Israel. You talk about a seed from up above, because we have a Jerusalem from up above. We're not talking about this physical geographical Jerusalem here that the Israelites or the Hebrews are at, or the Jewish people are here. We're not dealing with flesh and blood. We're dealing with an understanding of Yahshua, the Messiah. And that comes from a heavenly state of consciousness. And this is what we're here to study and to understand more clearly and perfectly. Now, I appreciate what Maria had expressed, because as she said, whether you've been here a long time or a short time, if your heart's desire in Yahweh, put it in your heart to reveal the things that he's revealed to all of us. This is why we're here. Whether we've been here a little while or a long while, Yahweh, is his will to do what he do according to his revelation of it. Because like she said, one can plant and one water, and there's been a lot of planters and waterers that come and gone, right? But yet we do no more than the same thing, and with a hope that Yahweh keep us, right? Steadfast in his teaching, in his righteousness. Because it's just going to be the sons that's going to be able to judge the world. You follow? And so we endeavor to be more perfect and clear in the migratory pattern and in the tabernacle pattern, and understanding how this pattern is made, or this how the man is made in the image of Elohim by the tabernacle pattern. And so that we can, what? Show forth proof of Yahshua. That's all we're here for. We already believe in Yahshua, in the name of Yahshua. We teach by the name of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. Some want to pick and choose when they want to say Yahweh, or they'll use Elohim in a prescribed time, or think Elohim is greater than Yahweh. They don't even know how the name works, really. Mm-hmm. They just jabbing at things when they pull a name and cast it out in front of their congregation. They don't have no rhyme nor hair what the name means. But we here now know. We've been taught by that word that Isaiah just talked about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua, and how that's a unity. And this is what we're endeavoring to, one, prove Yahshua. That's all we can do, is prove Yahshua. Prove Yahshua. Line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little, according to all the witnesses that are in your scriptures. Saul talks about, he done did so many things that books, there's not even enough books to contain all that what he's done. But because one doesn't understand who and what he is, they figured there's enough. They figured there's enough. But let's read about it here in the textbook. Second volume, page 14. We're going to start with Luke, confirms the interpretation of Matthew and Mark. Because we have what's called the four gospels in everybody's Bible. And we've now learned that those gospels aren't gospels at all. Okay? They are biographies. They're a biography about one Yahshua the Messiah, erroneously called Jesus. You follow? Now, we're going to read through this, and we're going to be looking at Acts, the second chapter. Acts, the second chapter, started 50 days after the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. You have what you call Pentecost, which is starting Acts, the second chapter. You have to know where these things are within your Bible, okay? And the Bible simply means a compilation of books. That's what a Bible means, a compilation of writings or of other books. You follow? Biblos in the Spanish. Now, now we're going to talk about those who were with Yahshua the Messiah before he died. And now we're going to read about the biography of what they wrote about Yahshua the Messiah while he was living. Now he's dead. Then he was living in the fourth dispensation. So now we're going to hear an excerpt about Luke confirming what Matthew and Mark wrote. Okay? Just take it away.
Luke confirms our interpretation of Matthew and Mark.
Okay.
Luke, the beloved physician, was not one of the 12 apostles, but had a profound knowledge of all that Yahshua began both to do and teach until the day he was taken up. He was a companion of the apostle Paul. Luke confirms our interpretation of Matthew and Mark by taking the plain statement that Yahshua said after his resurrection that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name, not in the water. Beginning at Jerusalem, Luke also wrote the Acts of Apostles, and in the record he said that the Holy Spirit, speaking through Peter the Apostle, had preached that Yahshua, whom they had crucified, had risen from the dead and sent them to preach the gospel.
Now, that's Luke, that Dr. Kenny is expressing, wrote Acts and wrote the book of Luke, so-called Gospel of Luke, okay, or the biography of what Luke wrote about. And he wrote Acts. He's a physician. He was an apostle. To make clear, an apostle is an eyewitness. An eyewitness to what? An eyewitness to the man, Yahshua the Messiah, while he walked around the Palestinian and Judean hills while he was in his ministry. Now, for one to go back and to speculate, well, didn't he work with him and his dad as a carpenter and building things? We're not going there. We're not going into that entourage of foolish questions, if you would. You follow? We are understanding that Yahshua began his ministry at 30 years old. So say the book. And we understand that he's fulfilling, as he expresses in Matthew 5:17. He's saying he's fulfilling because he's instituted it back here with this migratory pattern, beginning down here in Egypt when you have one Joshua or Yahushua from the son of Nun, simply meaning none after the flesh. You follow? And you have to understand that in learning anything about that Bible, you're going to have to accept allegories, analogies, metaphors, similes, correlations, in order to have any constructive understanding going forward about what that Bible is really depicting and showing. And what I'm telling you now is that Yahshua, the Messiah, came in to fulfill that what he instituted back here in Egypt and all the way back from the beginning of time, essentially. But the easy road, and one that we can see and make our correlations with most relatively now, is this migratory pattern set up after the tabernacle pattern, because we talked about it on Sunday. A most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. We have Jerusalem, or the Canaan's land, or the promised land, symbolic of the most holy place. You have the wilderness of Sinai, symbolic of the holy place. And you have the court roundabout, is symbolic of Egypt. That is your threefold makeup, with the River Jordan dividing the most holy place from the holy place, and the Red Sea dividing the holy place from the court roundabout, or Egypt. You follow? This is what we're looking at, and this is what Acts is going to be talking about when Luke is writing. They're looking at this pattern, if you would. Mm-hmm. Okay? Or this is how we're made to look at this pattern. Mm-hmm. All right? Keep reading. I lost my thought.
He repeated the words of the Great Commission. Mm. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Go ahead. Not in water.
And not in water. Now, it was Luke that expressing that he was told that when Peter rose up on the day of Pentecost, 50 days later, which is this plate right here, okay? 50 days later, after his resurrection, that he saw what and heard what Peter said about a baptism. You follow? And what we're going to understand is that there's a baptism that took place back here in Egypt. or coming up, or the children of Israel coming out of Egypt, there was a baptism that had taken place. And that was the start of the baptism. And what we're expressing is that when we read in Acts, is in as Yahshua the Messiah told them, his apostles, after he resurrected, that you're no longer going to be baptizing in water. Mm-hmm. And that you're going to be baptizing through a gospel or through preaching the gospel. You follow? That will be the baptism, if you would. Because we understand when he was baptized of John the Baptist here at the River Jordan, or at the River Jordan, that fulfilled or finished physical water baptisms that they had previously had instituted by way of the children of Israel being baptized in the Red Sea. Mm-hmm. You follow? I think was that 1 Corinthians 10 and 1? If you can grab that just to substantiate that statement. And again, being in a school, you found it?
Yeah.
Okay. In this school, you're able to ask questions and make clear. If you don't have a question, let's raise your hand and let's make it clear. Go ahead and read. What is it?
1 Corinthians 10:1.
All right.
Moreover, brethren,
yes,
I would not that you should be ignorant.
All right.
How that all our fathers was under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
This Red Sea is what he's talking about, Saul. Read.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
And that's that baptism that Yahshua is saying, you're not doing no more water baptisms. You follow? Mm-hmm. Let's keep reading back in the textbook. Beginning at Jerusalem, Luke.
For the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
What are you reading?
The next one.
No. Finish it. You get the big bold letters. Beginning at Jerusalem. We just got done. Repentance and remission of sins in big bold letters should be preached in his name, not in water. Because we're making clear that this baptism that all the other nations and denominations want to put you in. You follow? They want you to dress right. They want you to follow that Levitical priesthood law to the T. And they want to put you in water at some point in time. And we're letting you know that that's a lie. We're letting you know that Yahshua the Messiah himself, after he resurrected, he told his boys, hey, you no longer going to put anybody in the water. You say, what did it say? It say, scroll back down right there. It's saying in the middle of the thing, Luke confirms the interpretation of Matthew and Mark, right? And he skips through. And the repentance, this is how you're going to repent. And remit of sins should be preached in his name, not in water. That's what we're making. This is one of the big hubbubs that everybody want to have a contention about. Well, I need to get in some water, have it sprinkled on me, or get in a running water somewhere, some kind of water, and being like the eunuch, just get me wet. Mm-hmm. And we're letting you know that that's not what we're talking about anymore after Yahshua Messiah fulfilled water baptism and moved it out of the way. This is believing in the word. Okay? Now, let's pick up after that bold sentence there.
You want me to get Acts 2 and
No, not yet. We're going to get into it in a minute. But just keep reading. Beginning at Jerusalem.
Beginning at Jerusalem,
uh-huh.
Luke also wrote the Acts of Apostles.
Mm-hmm.
And in this record, he said that mm-hmm. the Holy Spirit, speaking through Peter the Apostle, had preached that Yahshua, whom they had crucified, had risen from the dead mm-hmm. and sent them to preach the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
He repeated the words of the Great Commission, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Not in water.
Not in water. Read.
For the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.
Now you're going to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit after you've been preached to. That's what happened 7 years later after Pentecost at Cornelius' house. You follow? When Peter preached unto those that were there, or the Gentiles, as it were. So this is a living thing, as Maria said. You got to take these, what we learn here, off the charts. You can memorize them all you want. It's good to do that. But let it be known, you have to live it and become these charts. You follow? And that's how you put it into operation. It's to be living in the Spirit, according to a consciousness. You follow? Having been immersed in the gospel or the word of Yahshua the Messiah, for he is the Holy Spirit. Everybody want to catch the Spirit? You can catch the Spirit every now and then. That's what they do in the other nations and other denominations. When they get the running off at their mouth and they get the jumping around and wigging out, they didn't caught it at that time. But all the other times, they ain't got nothing. They waited for the Holy Spirit to come capture them. But we walk in the Holy Spirit day in and day out. That's what this here is, present kingdom age, isn't it? There's only one kingdom, and you got to be in the Spirit to have righteousness, peace, and joy in it. Otherwise, you're a mess. You're nervous. You're scared. You're worried at every wind of doctrine, every problem that arises, because you have no confidence in the Holy Spirit or in Yahshua. Yeah, we can say his name and sing songs to him all day long, kumbaya. But if you don't believe him, he's not going to do a thing for you. That's why we got to use. That's why we rehearse. That's why we continue in the understanding of how it's put together. Because as Maria said, when you understand how it's put together, it will move you. That's why she's here for so many years. Yeah, she may not be running down the charts and doing every jot and tittle. But, hey, within her soul salvation, she's content. Mm-hmm. She know where to run the chart and know where to go to. She's not lost. Mm-hmm. Now, if anybody new coming here, they're not going to know where to go from Jump Street. Mm-hmm. She cool. Dr. Kinley said, come and learn all you can about this teaching or about Yahshua the Messiah. They diligent. We only hope we'll be so diligent, you follow, in knowing and even in this last day in time. Because people want to already put you ahead here. And there's some people operating way back here. And then some operating way, way back here. Truth be told, in their conscious sake, you follow. So now, let's go ahead and read about this Acts. Because my doc had a question about it. We wanted John to get to it because I missed it all day on Sunday. Repeating myself, as it were, as I've been told. Go ahead. Now, I want to skip the gospel according to John, because that's another whole book. I want to deal with Acts. And I wanted to start here with Luke, because Luke wrote Acts, you follow? And so now we're talking about how Luke confirmed Matthew and Mark, confirming that the baptism is not of water, but of the gospel. Water baptism after Pentecost, I don't want that neither. So let's just start at Acts of the Apostles, written by Luke, is an historical document and not a doctrinal epistle. Start at 16, please, page 16. Yep. Talking about Pentecost. That's after the first four books.
Acts of the Apostles.
And what we're doing, we're going to understand more clearly the layout of the land, as it were, because they done already killed Yahshua, hung him on the cross, buried him in Joseph's new tomb. That's a principle of why it's a new tomb. And then he resurrected early in the morning on the third day. That goes into Numbers at 2300. And everybody was talking about, they wanted to know something about this 2520 and that 490. It's coming. So be prepared. Keep coming. Because we're going to talk about all those numbers. And when the numbers get to be too much, we're going to keep digging in those numbers because they make sense. And we have the tools to study the numbers. Okay? So don't be dismayed. And don't think I'm trying to skivvy out on it. I just wanted to be clear. because I don't want this to be I want this to be the best delivery as possible, if I can put it that way. So I just don't want to just read textbook and then not really know how to put those numbers together, because there's a lot involved, but it can be done. Don't fear with that. Nonetheless, you got 3 days, and then he resurrected. Now, we say Pentecost was 50 days after he resurrected, or we may say 53 days when Yahshua the Messiah was put on the cross. You'll hear it differently in the lectures. So I'm just expressing that there was a whole lot going on in those 3 days prior to him resurrecting that also needs to be understood and made clear. But yet, I say after he resurrected, and those that he resurrected from the patriarchs from Adam on down, resurrected, he himself tarried on earth for 40 days. We'll have it read here, but give you a synopsis. 40 days. And he was showing himself to certain people. Now, it's expressed that 40 days, he told those apostles, I'm making it clear, he's talking to the apostles only. Just like Yahweh spoke to the children of Israel back here. You know, we say that if you only spoke to the children of Israel only. Gentile nation wasn't involved in this law. Well, I'm letting you know, when Yahshua Messiah was talking to these people back here, he wasn't talking to all of Israel. He was talking to his 12 boys. Specifically, 11 actually at this time. Mm-hmm. Let me be extra clear. Judas has already hung himself, right? So he's talking to his 11 only. Everybody else, they might have been around kicking it, but they not understanding because they weren't eyewitnesses. And what he's telling them to do is something different than what they thinking to do. We'll read it in a minute. But nonetheless, I want that to be clear that Yahshua is talking to the 11. When we read down through here, so that's clear, because we want to know who he's talking to and who's all up in this upper room and who are all these multitude of people. Is that almost close to your question? Close to your question, Doc? Yeah? All right. We're going there. Good. Let's keep rolling in.
Acts of the Apostles, written by Luke, is an historical document and not a doctrinal epistle.
Mm-hmm.
These questions and the misunderstanding concerning water baptism that have plagued so-called Christendom through the centuries are found in the historical document better known to us as the Acts of the Apostles, which was written by Luke while he was in Rome about AD 61 through 63.
Mm. Get your time frame, AD 61 to 63. Now I said, Yahshua poured out his Holy Spirit 50 days after he resurrected. Now, we're talking 61 years after Yahshua Messiah poured out his spirit. You have Luke writing about this event. He's not writing this event as though he's watching this Holy Spirit and watching Peter begin to start talking. I'm just putting it in perspective. Yeah. This is 61 years after the Gentiles is getting down with what's going on by this time, and Luke is just recanting what he's been told by Paul or Saul about what happened on this day. And mind you this, Saul wasn't here at Pentecost either. Mm-hmm. So that's something to be suspect and to understand and to make known that Paul ain't kicking it with Peter at this time. Paul didn't already have Stephen, or I didn't have Stephen, but he was there and sanctioned for Stephen to be stoned. Yeah. You follow? And he was persecuting the assembly all the while. So we got to understand who is here. And Doc just made reference. This book is one of the books that causes everybody to have problems and issues. Okay, let's keep rolling.
If Luke had not written the Acts of Apostles, Christendom would not have any record of the practice of water baptism.
They would have nothing pertaining to water baptism. And this is not an epistle. This is not an epistle of doctrine either. This is a biography or historical account. Because like I said, this is 61 years later after the Pentecost had transpired. Keep reading.
After the crucifixion of Yahshua and after the day of Pentecost,
okay,
to which they could have referred to establish the erroneous, carnal-minded interpretation of the Great Commission of Yahshua the Messiah.
That's those nations out there abundance in the world that want to pontificate about what how great the Lord is and what the Jesus Christ has done for them lately and what they tell you and deem you to do. They're figuring or assuming of this epistle or this historical account, and if it hadn't been for Luke, wouldn't have no idea what a baptism was. Nor what to do. Keep reading.
Paul did not continue the practice of water baptism because he said that Yahshua sent him not to baptize, but to preach the gospel.
We got a book on that?
1 Corinthians 1:14.
Let's grab it. Because that's a great statement. Because remember, Saul's is an apostle, made an apostle by Yahshua the Messiah to preach to the Gentiles. And he's telling us and the whole world that, hey, I'm not come to do what they done did back here under the law of Moses. Because Saul, being an apostle, know what Isaiah is talking about, know what Jeremiah is talking about, knows what the Holy Spirit is talking about. And now we're talking about what he said here in 1 Corinthians. Read.
I thank Yahweh that I baptized none of you but Crispus and Gaius.
Okay.
Lest any should say that I have baptized in my own name. And I baptized also the household of Cephas.
Mm-hmm.
Besides, I know not whether I baptize any other.
Now, he had a whole lot of boys with him, and he only did those few. If you read around and read through, he did that only because of the Nazarite rite that they were doing and going through at that particular time. That's something to be drawn out and to express why he baptized those two. Mm-hmm. But keep reading.
For the Messiah sent me not to baptize.
Immerse or immerse. Baptize, immerse, submerge. However you want to frame it, he's not baptizing nobody. Mm-hmm. Saul the apostle, the 12th. Read.
But to preach the gospel.
But to preach the gospel.
Not with the wisdom of words, lest the sacrifice of the Messiah should be made of none effect.
See, not memorizing with just words, like Maria said. We're not up here just memorizing with just words and blah, 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 of what the Messiah say or what Dr. Kinney say. No. We're expressing an understanding that baptism is not done with water. Mm-hmm. And the whole world has been duped to and lied to get you to consider you have a salvation in being dunked in water. But let's go back to the textbook. Since we got the evidence that Saul ain't baptized nobody. Read.
Luke sent his historical document to His Excellency Theophilus,
okay,
a person in high official position,
mm-hmm,
in writing the Acts of Apostles, as it is called. It is apparent that Luke had no intentions whatsoever of writing an authoritative or apostolic pastoral epistle,
okay,
nor did he address it to anyone of the churches or congregational assemblies established by the apostles in local or foreign territories.
You see, apostles established. Luke ain't established nothing. It's the apostles that established. And no deacon, nobody else was doing anything. That's why I make the statement when Yahshua is speaking to them here in those 40 days that he's tearing around here, he's talking to the apostles only. Because they're the only ones that know anything about anything, because them were the 12 he taught. Mm-hmm. Yes, there was a multitude around at various times, but he taught to them in fables. You follow? And you, I can go back into there, and because they ask him, they ask Yahshua, why are you speaking in fables, man? Just speak plain. And he told them why. Because it was for them to know. So when he died, he buried and resurrected, and he resurrected on earth for 40 days, he's talking to them because they're the ones that know. Because he was taught. That will make them eyewitnesses or apostles. And they're the ones that established the then known assemblies, not churches. That wasn't even established yet. But nonetheless, let's keep reading.
He wrote a true record of past or current events in defense of Yahshua the Messiah.
Now he's defending Yahshua the Messiah as though he needed any. But keep reading.
His disciples in the ministry, the Jewish and Gentile disciples or converts.
Okay, you see now, we say, remember, it was 61 years after the fact, Cornelius and preaching, Peter preaching at Cornelius' house was 7 years after Pentecost, and now we're some 50 years down the road. That's why he's saying now you have the Gentile who are converts that believe the report in what had transpired on the day of Pentecost. Mm-hmm. And what the report was from the apostles, nobody else. That's why this old eunuch down here couldn't nothing happen to this eunuch down here when Philip baptized this eunuch down here in water. Wasn't nothing coming down on him. He didn't know hands come down. He had to go. They had to go wait and go see Peter. But that's another story. So we're expressing that you got Gentiles that have been converted. You got the old Israels that are understanding something about what the apostles said. Read.
And sent it to Theophilus, hoping to relieve them of further or continued persecution for preaching the gospel of the Messiah.
Mm.
In A.D. 43, Herod the king stretched forth his hand and killed the apostle James.
This is what we got. This is this image right here. Down here, this is this image. This is what we're talking about here in 43, A.D. 43. This is what we're looking at. King Herod slaying James, laying down here, dead as sure as dead. Read.
And imprisoned Peter.
Mm-hmm.
But the angel released Peter. In A.D. 61 through 63, when Luke wrote the Acts of the Apostles,
33 and 34,
he had spent many years with Paul, Peter, and others in the ministry.
In 35.
He also engaged in communication with them in the apostolic councils.
The apostolic councils. We'll talk about that possibly. Read.
Held at Jerusalem and Antioch.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, Luke knew and understood the true doctrine of Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
As taught by word of mouth by all of the true apostles of the Messiah.
All the true apostles of Yahshua the Messiah. Luke was taught. Mm-hmm. This is our reason why we say the gospel of Luke is not a gospel. Luke didn't know nothing of him by himself and of himself. You follow? These three charges, what she just talked about. You have this blood. Right one. No, this is a persecution. So this is Stephen being persecuted. But here, this play here, 34. This is James with King Herod killing him. And then you have Peter preaching. You have Peter down here in prison. And you can go through Acts 12 and talk about how Peter was escaped from prison and the manner in which he escaped from prison. Mm-hmm. It's all relevant, okay? So keep reading. We got these plates set up for our learning to understand this book of Acts, because it's not just a one read and done, you know? Keep reading.
Moreover, he understood the principles of the doctrine taught in their epistles.
He understood principles or precepts. And this is why we say blood, water, spirit, 40, ascension. These are principles or precepts that we read according to the scriptures of what was written by the prophets. You follow? and by the law of Moses, because the prophets are merely drawn out from what Moses wrote. You follow? That keeps the consistency, and that's what makes that Bible a beautiful book, as Maria expressed. It's a beautiful doctrine because it shows in how everything is connected and interwoven and in its perfect place if you just let it be. And you have an open heart and an open mind and listen to what thus say the Spirit as he revealed it to Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley. That's all we're expressing. We're not telling you to drink no Kool-Aid. We're not telling you to give us no money. We're not asking for anything other than to pay attention. You follow? And the scriptures will reveal themselves. Keep reading.
Revealed to the apostles by the Holy Spirit, which Yahshua, the Messiah himself, promised they would receive after his departure.
He only talked to the apostles, and only the apostles were going to receive the Holy Spirit. And that's what was teaching everybody all the way down through. And as they learned it, as Luke said that he learned it, then he was able to share that to somebody else. And that's no different than me. Because mind you, 5, 10, 15 years ago, you couldn't get nothing out of me. Got confusion. I already knew the name Yahweh Elohim Yahshua was never saying Jesus, but I still couldn't convert or express anything of the true gospel until that righteousness that Isaiah is talking about got into a person, and I didn't put it there. I had no part of it. You follow? But when it comes and it's in line, it will read and it will run the principles throughout which we're expressing to everybody. The whole world has a free opportunity to comprehend the gospel that the apostles received first, then to Samaria, and then the other parts of the world. That's how Yahshua expresses it back there with Matthew and Mark. Mm-hmm. This is how it's going to go down, boys. Yep. Y'all going to be my 12, just like those 12 of Jacob, of that seed that we talked about in Isaiah,
right.
Of that seed, plural, singular of the Abraham, but plural of Jacob. That Jacob having those 12 seeds. And now you got those 12 boys, which is a fulfillment of those 12 tribes, right? Those 12 sons of Jacob. This is that fulfillment of that. And this is why the 12 are important. Even though Judas hung himself, Saul was replaced in chapter 9 on the road to Damascus. He's converted. Okay? And he gets in line. You follow? As we all going to get, as Maria said, you get in line when you begin to change your demeanor and your outlook towards life and how you deal with people. This gospel will change you. That's that changing of that inner man within you to look and to abide by the law of Yahweh. That's that second covenant, if you would. That's the understanding and hearing Yahweh. Ain't nothing written. Can't bring me nothing written and tell me to do that. Without a doubt, never going to do it. But if you speak according to a gospel, and I see the principles by which we've been taught of the Holy Spirit and not of man, I have to either accept or wait for the Holy Spirit to change. That's something we will deal with later. But keep reading.
Without another water baptism,
mm-hmm.
For as Yahshua said, John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit.
Now that's John the Baptist. That's not Saint John or the John that you got there writing the gospel. You're talking about this John here, that John truly baptized. Mm-hmm. And he was the last one that truly baptized, is what he's saying. John truly baptized. Mm-hmm. That was the last true baptisms there was to be had, was that of Yahshua the Messiah. Truthfully, verily, I'll say unto you, that was the last baptism, because that was the fulfillment of this initial baptism of the children of Israel in the Red Sea. We keep reading.
Not water, not many days hence.
Mm-hmm.
As you read Luke's reference to water baptism in the Acts of the Apostles concerning Philip, Peter, and Apollos,
mm-hmm.
Recognize that so-called Christendom many years after the decease of the apostles mm-hmm. has used this historical document instead of the doctrinal epistles of the apostles to reestablish John's water baptism of repentance under the disguise of Christian water baptism to represent the Great Commission which Yahshua gave the apostles in Matthew 28 and 19.
All right. Now, we had all that said, and we're following it, right? Number one, Luke is writing this 61 years after Pentecost. Number two, what was spoken of by the apostles and nobody else, and that it was the apostles that were teaching the people. You follow? Now, we're expressing here that they were persecuted because he said here that Luke sent this historical memoir to those who were being persecuted so they know how it really went down, essentially. This is the way it went down is what this acts or this historical document is being expressed or sent to those by Theophilus. Now, we know, and he's expressed, that James got killed. And we know that the apostle, that the preaching or the Holy Spirit came unto Cornelius and his household 7 years later. You follow? Grafting in the Gentiles to be converted, to believe in the apostles' gospel. You follow? That's what they were converted to, was the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. They weren't baptizing nobody. They weren't doing no Eucharist or no wafers or no wine for years. But after the apostles had deceased, you follow? This is where you get this plate and where you get the carnal ordinances being restored by the then known patriarchs or the fathers of that time or the Antichrist or those who started to establish these false traditions according to a historical document that clearly states water baptism is out, but because they didn't understand it according to the gospel of the apostles, then they were duped in restoring these carnal ordinances. This is how they brought back the Ten Commandments, or what we have here, these 613 judgment statute and ordinances, in part, not at all in totality, because things, times have changed, and they stopped doing such and such and such and such. But they brought back the ones that suited them and what they like. Just like you can go out here and run out here and go to any denominations, and they're going to give you a sprinkling of some of these ordinances. You follow? And to me, it don't make a difference which one they're going to do. And if they put it on you to do, they got a problem. Yeah. You follow? It's for self-gain or self-righteousness or the displaying of carnality. You follow? It cloaked as the devil, in other words. Lying to you about a book they don't know nothing about. About a historical document they don't know nothing about, trying to make it some kind of a ecclesiastical document and pulling out, according to an imagination, that baptism and whatever act they're going to have you to do is not profitable. You follow? They're taking on this delusion, if you would. And this is what they've become according to their gospel. Their gospel, but the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah preached by the apostles, holding it down for as long as they can hold it down for, because as Doc said, hey, our day is sure to come, and if you can pass it on, that we're going to preach the true gospel. And then that's Yahweh, and that's the purpose of Yahweh, because he said there in Isaiah that what he preached or what he sends out is not going to return back to him void. And it's this gospel that we're talking about, not an individual, but a gospel, but an understanding or a consciousness of souls that believe in Yahweh. Not a lie, not a delusion. And there's peril if you believe in that. Peril, I'll just say that word. Let's keep reading. We're getting to your question, Doc, but we're just going to go slow and easy.
Or the washing of regeneration by the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Compare John 7:38 with John 13:3 through 17. In other words, after the decease of the apostles, Christendom has confused John's water baptism of repentance with the Great Commission by using the Acts of the Apostles instead of using the doctrinal epistles of the apostles themselves. All three of the previous questions posed as related to the continued practice of water baptism can be answered and clearly understood by returning to the teaching of Yahshua the Messiah and his last conversation with the 11 apostles, not deacons, who were hearers and eyewitnesses.
See, there's a specific reason why they're apostles and not deacons. Okay, and we're touching on baptism here, and it's a good one, although we are soundly sure that there's no water saving us to be baptized in. But it's critical that we understand the event of this water baptism, because that's what one of the things that confounds and confuses, and people have a lot of questions about. So understanding how this goes is something we'll circle back around to as it is expressed. They're confusing the Acts of Apostles of what happened on Pentecost, you follow, when Peter stood up in the midst of them and spoke about a baptism, versus what the apostles wrote in the apostles' letters of Matthew, Mark, and John. You follow? There's a confusion in the delivery of that. Okay? So keep reading.
All of that he, Yahshua, had spoken, and that which had taken place up to and including the time of his ascension.
Mm-hmm.
For example, Yahshua said just before his ascension, "For John truly baptized with water first, after which ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit, not water, not many days hence." Yahshua said that the apostles, not the deacons, shall be witnesses unto me beginning at Jerusalem, and then in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Yahshua, in his teaching, had told his disciples or the apostles.
Okay, hold on right quick. Yahshua resurrected there. After his resurrection, he's talking to his 11. Remember? Judas hung himself. Mm-hmm. He's talking to his 11 about what they're going to do. He's not talking to the multitude. This is getting to your question, Doc.
Right.
And so now he's got 11 here, and he's going to be to Jerusalem first. Because remember, Jerusalem is a type of heaven or the most holy place. You follow? And there's an order that by which he's going to go as that word is going to go out too. Jerusalem first, Judea, then Samaria, and then the other most parts of the world. It's critical that we understand that, because this is how it's going to unfold, if you would. Okay? Let's keep reading and see who else is here.
Yahshua, in his teaching, had told his disciples or apostles, not deacons, mm-hmm. before he died, "These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you.
Mm-hmm.
But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, Yahshua mm-hmm. the Messiah,
mm-hmm.
he shall teach you all things."
Now, before he died, he's expressing this to his 11. Not everybody, not all the Jews. He's only his 11. He's expressing this to that the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, and it says it in everybody's book, is Yahshua. That's why we put a name on Yahshua. There's no other denominations, as Maria had testified to, that has these charts, that has this vision, that has this report about Yahshua the Messiah. And I'm letting you know, I've yet to come across any denomination, and trust me, I haven't been everywhere, but if you know of one, let me know if you know of anybody that gives the Holy Spirit a name. I look forward to it. Do they give the Holy Spirit a name? And we just read here that Yahshua the Messiah told his 11 boys that, hey, I'm going to come back to you, and I'm going to be the one who's going to intercess for you. And it's going to be the Holy Spirit, which I am, that's going to tell you all things. Not no speaking in tongues and what they'll have you to believe, they're running and jumping around that they, as though they caught the Holy Spirit. No, the Holy Spirit speaks just as I'm speaking to you now, plain and clear. You follow? You know, you don't see me fall on the floor. No one's up here trying to hold and catch me and keep me in tune. I have no music playing in the background to get me gyrating and doing anything outside of myself other than preaching the gospel, breaking down what is being said in a book. You follow? Let's keep going and see if we can catch the continuity of thought.
He shall teach you all things mm-hmm. and bring all things to your remembrance mm-hmm. whatsoever I have told you.
Whatsoever they have told you. These 11, not the multitude. Yes, there was 5,000 he talked to and preached to at Mars Hill, or at different, not Mars Hill, but at different points in time. Where's that? On the Mount of Olives, when he sat, he fed a multitude with fishes and spoke to them. He wasn't teaching them the things he taught the apostles, what I'm expressing to you. And what he taught the apostles was what they spoke to the people after Pentecost. He told them fables. He told them the reality of it. That's the purpose of Yahweh. That's what he's getting at to. You follow? Just as he set the children of Israel up. I said, set the children of Israel up as an example for the whole world to see his power and his name. That's what Yahweh did for the children of people, for the children of Israel. You follow? And he did that, one, primarily for Pharaoh to see. Let me make it really clear.
Right.
Pharaoh being likened unto a Gentile that know not Yahweh. He's going to see the power and in the name of Yahweh. That's why the name is important this day and age. That's why we can't just let it go and just accept any old thing when it's a lie. Because it's the truth that's going to make you free. Mm-hmm. Just accept that. If it's a lie, it's a lie. Get in line with it, and it can be proven to you why it's not so. So he set the children of Israel up because they were given the law to make the law exceedingly sinful, whereby they weren't going to be able to fulfill it at no time. It took Yahshua, the Messiah, to come in and to fulfill it or to finish it or to move it out of the way. That's what they were duped by. That's the stumbling block of the scriptures, that they know not what it's about. It says it in the book, the stumbling block unto the Jews and to the Greeks. They can't figure it out unless they have a divine vision and revelation preached and taught to them about what it was all about. And the Jews are still in a quandary as to what to do. They don't even believe that he was the one, yeah. Let alone other things, right? So now we're breaking it down and expressing about these boys, 12, or these 11 at the then known time. Let's keep reading.
Now when Yahshua had finished fulfilling the law and the prophecies, he was crucified. And mm-hmm. as the Apostle Paul said, all carnal ordinances, including circumcision and water baptism, were nailed to the cross.
Colossians 2 and 14. Let's get that, please. Colossians 2 and 14, expressing that all carnal ordinances, carnal meaning physical, fleshly, things to do, getting in water, eating a wafer, drinking a thimble of grape juice, any such things, tithing in the name of the Lord, anything of that such nature, is foolishness unto Yahweh.
Colossians 2 and 14,
uh-huh.
blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us.
See, us ain't you. Us is the Jews. That's Saul is a Jew. Saul is a Jew. That's why he can say us. Mm-hmm. I heard ministers the other day listening. They say us. He thinking it's him. Mm-hmm. He not a Jew. He's African American, and he's not. He can't talk in place of Saul. Saul can say us, and that's why I say it was given to them, us, those Jews back here in this day, as a stumbling block. They're being set up, and he says what? Saul.
And took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
He took that which he set them up with and took it out of the way. By what? Coming in the flesh and blood, in a likeness of sinful flesh, in order to move it out of the way.
Right.
For those Jews, Gentiles was never given a law to begin with. They did by nature those things that they did. They were sacrificing and worshiping and doing all other sorts of things, right? Just did that by nature. But Yahshua did what he did for a particular reason. It's why we got the Bible. It's what makes it a significant book. It makes it a real story that you can believe in and sink your teeth in to see how these boys were duped and how Yahshua fulfilled it and moved it out of the way so that they can believe in what? Keep reading.
And having spoiled principalities and powers, mm-hmm. he made a show of them openly, mm-hmm. triumphing over them in it.
Mm-hmm.
Let no one condemn you regarding sacrificial meal and drink offerings.
See, don't be condemned in your consciousness and they say, well, you need to do this and you need to do that. Because they're going to lay it on real heavy. Real heavy they're going to lay it on. But that's another story. Keep reading.
Made on the holy days, new moon.
Your holidays, your Easters, and they put a lot of pressure on you to do a lot of things on these holy days and holidays. And we're saying don't fear in none of that. Don't be condemned in your consciousness about it because we're giving you the true report. Saul said that Yahshua came in to fulfill it and to hang it on the cross, and it sure is done. Keep reading.
Which are a show of things to come, mm-hmm. but the substance is the Messiah.
I said it's a show of things going to come. It's going to get worse. But the substance is what?
The Messiah. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen. Vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind.
Them psychics that want to tell you about things and express you things beyond what you already know and heard if you've been in this gospel any amount of time and you believe what you believe. People are coming in, and I tell you one good one, they come in and tell you you're in the seventh dispensation in the fifth age too. Reread what you just said right there, please.
Let no man beguile you.
Let no man beguile you, right? Read.
Of your reward.
Now you got a reward. You got to have something. You got to have an understanding of the gospel to have something in order to be beguiled. Hey, Eve was beguiled. True?
True.
She had something.
Yeah.
And she didn't know she had it.
Yeah.
But see, now we'll be going over this rehearsing, this report, these stories, you want to call them stories, going over and rehearsing and seeing how it really was true. We now know we're not as Eve.
Mm-hmm.
Because Eve was deceived, Adam wasn't. And that deception is this deception of iniquity or of the delusion, you follow, if you don't know the purpose and pattern and plan of Yahweh. You're likened to an Eve, listening to that satanic angel or thought within your own consciousness, alone and by yourself in darkness. Naive to anything of Yahweh. Not believing in the truth of Yahweh. Because you believe your truth is Jesus. You believe your truth is the Lord. Denying the proof and the witnesses that Adam knew not to touch of that fruit. But what did he do? Because of the purpose, died willingly in order to bring forth a purpose. Yahweh's purpose to degenerate the first man and bring him down. And he brought him down and came through the history of time as we've come to know. And we're talking about this death, this burial, and this resurrection at the appropriate time, right on time, in order to ascend into heaven. You follow? And when he ascended, he poured out this knowledge that one can know today, that they couldn't know yesteryears. Mm-hmm. Because it was imposed on them, and on them Jews, not you Gentiles, but the Jews, it was imposed on them not to know. Because he had a way of escape for them already. Who do you think rose up with him when he rose up after he rose up out of the grave? He went back and captured those who believed. Hey, there was some that was lost. Mm-hmm. So I'm talking about, I can't go there neither. There were souls that rose up and they tarry here at this altar. And they're intercessing for us. Because when we go back to Moses and go back to Jeremiah and Isaiah and our patriarchs and Saul and Peter and Timothy and such writers in that book, and we with the sons of Yahweh. You see, these sons of Yahweh up here, depicted here, this is where we'll be in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah. Coming from a unity into a body of people with the gospel of the knowledge of who and what he is. You follow? From Adam all the way down to Yahshua the Messiah. Because that was the end right there. Because we're in the kingdom now. Mm-hmm. According to a righteousness, peace, and harmony where we ought to be dwelling in. Let's keep reading a little bit more in the book. I don't want to pontificate too much.
It is also vitally important mm-hmm. that we notice with extreme care
okay.
that Yahshua the Messiah himself did not write and leave any kind of written document or epistle or instruction to be used as a guide by the apostles after his ascension. Why? Because of two basic and fundamental reasons, which are as follows. The reason he did not write is because he came to fulfill that which was already written of him in the law and prophets.
And see, he was written by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So say Peter there in 2 chapter 1 and 28. They were divinely inspired. Right. The word that is to and through those apostles and Moses to write what they wrote. And that there is the Holy Spirit. And we just got done talking about the Holy Spirit telling his 11 boys that, hey, not soon, many days later, I'm going to enter into you and I'm going to tell you all the things to say of what I've already told you about. It's the same Spirit. So he didn't need to write nothing. This is why we need to know and understand about the Old Testament. Can't kick the Old Testament out and think you're going to get be some new age Christian. Don't even let me start. Keep reading.
The scriptures which were revealed and written by Moses mm-hmm. and the prophets mm-hmm. many years before Yahshua was born.
That's right.
Said, wherefore he saith, when he cometh into the world, sacrifices and burnt offerings or carnal ordinances, thou wouldest not.
That's right. That's them carnal ordinances that we just got done talking about. Read.
But a body hast thou prepared for me.
But there's going to be a body that was going to be prepared for him. Read.
Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book as it is already written of me.
Mm-hmm.
To do thy will, O Yahweh, he taketh away the first that he may establish the second. Therefore, instead of Yahshua adding thereto by establishing or instituting more cardinal ordinances, he came to remove those which were under the first covenant in order to establish the new covenant written in the heart
and mind of those who believe the report. Now, she just read it eloquently, way better than I can oftentimes express it. And we talked about this law, these laws that the children of Israel were instituted with, that was written by Yahweh. 10 of them anyways. Something we're looking at now in my consciousness is understanding that Moses wrote some 613 judgment statutes and ordinances, right? And we say that this law here was the Ten Commandments, written by Moses. But we have to understand that this first, on that second trip, Moses received these tables of stones that Yahweh wrote these Ten Commandments on. You follow? And he came down this mountain, and this is a type and a shadow. This is where you got to understand analogies and a metaphor whereby this first tables of stone that Yahweh wrote on, Moses cast them down and broke them, meaning the commandments and all that the children of Israel wanted, or the denominations now want you to do and follow, is after this first broken law that Moses has set up. And he demonstrates it by breaking it. Now, 40 days later, you have Moses on the third trip coming back in to the mountain after he hewed out his own tables of stone and put it back in the cleft of this rock, as it's read there in the 34th chapter of Exodus, that Moses again wrote this law and this in the tables of stone. But yet this set of law, written by Yahweh, who's going to write it in your heart and mind, this set of law was put in this Ark of the Covenant, in the most holy place, which is a replica of the sun, or Yahweh Elohim. You follow? Whereby they had to follow this cloud. And whereby what we're expressing is the new covenant now is having Yahweh, or Yahshua, written in our heart and mind, whereby we now are able to follow and believe and do, not be stiff-necked, not take on the same potency and attitude of our past fathers, if you would, in the spirit, not doing, not following the law of Yahweh, but now have it been written in us to follow and not deny. That's what we're striving to do. And as we believe this report, the easier it is to believe that he's going to take care of us in our world, in our time, in our situations, in our shortcomings, and that he will persevere and guard us, as it were, put a hedge around us in things pertaining to COVID and things pertaining to murders and shootings. It might get real close. It might even stingy here and there, but you'll have the faith and confidence in whatever happened, be Yahweh will, be Yahweh will. You follow? Let's keep reading.
He, Yahshua, himself said to the scribes and Pharisees while he was in the flesh, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law and prophets, but to fulfill. And verily, verily, I say that one jot or one tittle of the law or prophets shall in no wise pass away until all shall be fulfilled."
Okay, we got that. Let's go to number two. If you don't got that, you can read it up. Call us, write us. We'll get you a printed PDF format of the transcript or of the textbook, and you can read at your heart's content. It's all relevant, but we're going to skip on to number two.
Number two. Yes. The reason Yahshua did not write the apostolic instructions with pen and ink during his lifetime was because after his ascension, or from Pentecost, he being a life-giving spirit.
He being the life-giving spirit now. Follow? We're at Pentecost. Read.
Or the Holy Spirit written in the hearts and minds of the apostles would bring all things to their remembrance.
Now you have to know something. Just like the apostles had to know something. Those 11 boys had to know something. He spent 3.5 years with Yahshua the Messiah. They had to know something for him to be able to come into them in order to preach something to them for them to do. It's just not by circumstance. No one's come into this world perfect in that regard. You follow? Everybody has to go through a pattern. You follow? That's what makes it no big eyes and no little U's. That's why you can tell me something, but that don't mean you. That don't mean you understand. That don't mean you know. Even though you memorize the book, don't mean diddly squat to me. You follow? Because it's written in your heart and mind. Let's see how it's supposed to happen. Keep reading. We got a little bit of time left.
That he had told them while he was yet with them in the flesh.
Yeah.
This, of course, is not understood by carnal-minded so-called Christendom.
Oh, I don't say it like that, but he go ahead and say it, Doc.
Even unto this day, A.D. 1969, Yahshua, before and after his...
That goes back to 2022, mind you. Keep reading.
Yahshua before and after his crucifixion explained thoroughly.
Yes.
These things have I spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things.
Now, he's not talking to you and me. He's not talking to you and me. He's talking to the apostles. That's who the you is in that, not you. Keep reading.
And bring all things to your remembrance, mm-hmm. whatsoever I have said unto you.
Now, Yahshua had to have said something to you first. That's why we know coming in here, not having been under the ears or the sounds of this teaching, you're not coming from anywhere with any divine understanding. Carnally minded, just like Doctor said, anybody who's not been under the guise of this teaching are coming in carnally minded and are dead, are in like into darkness, like into Egypt, persecuting plagues and whatnot, in darkness, not understanding. You follow? Not having Yahshua written in you to for anything to be said through you. That's why we don't need to listen. We don't need to go to a whole lot. We'll let you speak, but we're not going to go into no whole long discourse about it because it's already, what we say, the writing's on the wall. You don't know. You don't understand. It's carnal. Whatever it is you say, it's carnal right away because it hasn't been baptized in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Or understood through the teaching of Yahshua the Messiah, or the Holy Spirit, if you would. Or never gotten any tongues. Never had that spirit put on you, if you would. You follow? Keep reading a little bit more. I got some time.
After he had risen from the dead, he mm-hmm. explained again mm-hmm. that John truly baptized with water.
Yes.
But you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit,
mm-hmm.
not many days hence mm-hmm. after his ascension.
Right. This not many days after his ascension. Why he say that? Understanding that was 40 days, because this is a 40 period or 40 plate within this pattern on this chart here, that this 40 days here represented a fulfillment of the 40 days here in the wilderness, tearing with his people. You follow? And now when he ascended, not many days after he ascended here. Remember, they all saw him go up, and everybody think he's still up there. But he said not many days after he's left. What did he say? Does it say? Go ahead, read.
This statement of Yahshua's was called to Peter's remembrance after he had commanded Cornelius the Gentile to be baptized in water.
Yes.
After Cornelius and his household had been baptized with the Holy Spirit.
Uh-huh.
The Holy Spirit, or Elohim,
yes,
again called this to Peter's remembrance or attention.
Yes.
Because it was contrary to the promise which Elohim had made to Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
For Peter or anyone else to baptize the Gentiles in water before or after they had received the Holy Spirit simultaneously with Peter's command to baptize the Gentiles or Cornelius at his household, the Holy Spirit again brought back to Peter's remembrance that John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit.
And that's what happened on the day of Pentecost, not many days after he ascended, 10 days to be exact. That makes that 50 or Penti, because that's what 50 means. It means Penti. Now you got Pentecost. And that Holy Spirit went into those 12. Those 12 alone. Although there was 120 in the upper room, those 12 received it. Keep reading the last little bit.
For this reason, Peter himself objected and withdrew the command.
Yes.
For them to be baptized with water, as he thereafter explained in his own words among the other apostles and elders.
Look, he explained thereafter in his own words among the other apostles and elders, read.
At Jerusalem and Antioch, to which they all agreed with him. And as we will finish explaining later under the caption below.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Great workshop.
I got
this concludes this evening's workshop. Are there any announcements? We hold classes here in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring your enemies and friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and forever. Let's all say hallelujah.